So my name is Roy, and I am here to try to talk about IoT. I feel like I'm sort of the odd one out in this conference. There's so much about cloud, and I am going to take it down to these really small devices. So hopefully I will explain to you why that is feasible and why it becomes more and more approachable these days. Even coming from the web stack, you can use a lot of those tools to approach IoT. And a bit about myself. I am a developer. I moved back and forth from the web stack and backend and some embedded. And when sort of IoT became a thing, this all came together for me. So there is my space. What I will take you through is basically a short intro of we're going to touch a lot of ground here. So I'll try to introduce the subjects as we go through them, and also a process where these tools fit. And we're going to talk about Elixir and Nerves. Have anybody heard of Elixir before? Anybody used it? Played with it? Nerves? Anybody Nerves? No. Okay. So there's an introduction for you today then. And hopefully together, after this one, I will be able to show an LED blink, which is the hello world of embedded. Everybody has to show an LED to blink, so let's do that. This is going to be an introduction talk, so everything will be sort of just scratching the surface. A bit disclaimer before we start. There's going to be two sort of parallel tracks here. One is the one I just showed you about Elixir and Nerves, and I'm going to show you how to build product with these tools and how fast you can actually build products with hardware. And with that power comes great responsibility. So I will also have a parallel track where I try to hide as good as I can, showing you that not all IDs are worth putting out in the world. Some of these things cannot be unseen, and not all of them are technology related. And one of them is like this. Not everything should be built. And yes, it's fake. So first of all, Internet of Things is a buzzword. It's a marketing term, like we heard about the cloud and all those stuff. This is also, it's really embedded that meets internet, or embedded that has networking, which it didn't have before. So when I'm talking about IoT, I'm really meaning devices. We can use the word IoT, that's more catchy, and that's why I put it in the title of the talk, because it attracts more people. Devices, you wouldn't be here. So this is also part of the reason. And basically it's hardware that is now capable of connecting to the internet, and maybe not even the internet. Maybe it's a closed network. Maybe you're in a military situation where you cannot be publicly, but still you can use the same techniques because now it's available and cheaper. And also when I'm talking about devices, I'm not talking about necessarily the cloud. It doesn't always make sense that IoT has to go through the cloud. Sometimes it's just an unnecessary loop. If you're talking about smart home situations, if you cannot enter your house because your internet is down, then it's not fun anymore, because your backbone is through AVS or something like that. So we need to start thinking about local connectivity as well. Don't get me wrong, cloud back really is a thing. When we're talking about sensors, to have these analyzed in the cloud really makes sense, but it shouldn't be everything. It shouldn't be centered around. When all these vendors talk about cloud, I won't mention name, but you all know who they are, that provides IoT frameworks connected to the cloud. I think we can do better. That's my point. And when we're talking about devices, we need standards, and we have lots of them. We have MQTT, WebSocket, AMQP, we have HTTP, TCP, UDP, which all make sense in different scenarios. I happen to like MQTT, but it's not always the the right choice. I think we should listen to Dan North when it says it depends, because it really does. Sometimes MQTT is not enough. Sometimes you need transactional security, and then you need something like AMQP. What you shouldn't do is roll your own, because then we get this one, which is not what we want. And unfortunately, a lot of people do hand roll their own standards because we want to. And it's not invented here syndrome, unfortunately, a bit common. The next one we need to talk about is security. Don't make this an afterthought. We've all heard in the news about these sort of IoT enabled attacks. The last one was DIN DNS, I think it was, which was attacked by millions of devices which had their default password set. So it's basically a botnet and million nodes hitting your server, you go down. This is what they did. So don't let the next article be about you and your product. Let's try to avoid that. So don't make it an afterthought. Not all publicity is good. Oh, there's one of those again. Not a good idea. A process. We need a diagram in every talk, so I had one too. This is about where I will show you where Elixir and Nerves fit into this process, and this is just one of them. You start with nothing, poor and broke, and you get an ID. You start to prototype, and you get funding, and this is also a very interesting place, actually, where crowdsourcing these days. You can get feedback and not put all these terrible ideas out there. And now you need to build the product, which is also becoming more available these days, because now you have small batch production of hardware is actually robot assembled. So you don't need to build 1,000 devices to have this affordable. You can build 60 and put them out in the market, which is a fairly new thing. And support is also, I put it out there because it's like in Tesla's case, the product becomes better as longer you own it because of the self-drive autopilot, I think it's called. Everywhere but Germany, it's called autopilot. And that is really something, if you can update it, if you can update the firmware, it can become better as longer you own it. And there are a lot of possibilities to have more sort of loops in this one. For instance, you go to ID to prototype the funding and then back and iterate. And this is really what I will talk about with Nerves, which can enable you to iterate faster, even including hardware. And get feedback. Now you can iterate 100 times where you before just could do one. So instead of these best guess first, you actually learn how to build it and you adapt to that one. I think that's one of the strengths these days with all the stacks and tools that we have available. And there are lots of arrows missing. And if you step wrong anywhere here, you end back to nothing, poor and broke. Especially if you screw up with support, I guess. but okay. Prototyping. This is really where I will zoom in to show you how to iterate there. ID you have to come up with yourself. I wouldn't share it if I had a good one. Prototyping. What's really available these days is a lot of prefabricated systems and modules. You have all these vendors like Adafruit and SparkFun and basically all of eBay full of these ones. You have these sensor devices that you can just plug in and read temperature and humidity and all kinds of sensors and actuators are available prefabricated. It's not going to be the perfect, you're not going to build a new iWatch with that one, but you're prototyping with these. And you can prototype really fast. You can pick up a lot of different sensors for your use case and assemble the prototype, which will look ugly, but it will work and do the stuff you need. And then you move forward in the process with production. And also open source is really fueling this process that you can prototype this fast, because now you can build on top of what others have built. And Elixir and Nerves are really open source. It's everything from the get-go is open sourced. Open hardware. Do you know, have anybody heard about open hardware? Do you know what that is? A few. It's basically the same as software, only that you make your PCB layouts available. BeagleBone Black is probably the best example of this one. A Raspberry Pi is partly, I think I will touch in on that on a later slide. But it's basically you start with these devices that is looks like this, and they provide you the layout so you can tweak it, and it's yours. You can, it's the same principle as open source. So that combined with all the modules, that is also almost always open hardware. You can build your own PCB if you want that. And on top of that, you probably need a casing, which where 3D printing is really coming together. And 3D printing is just in its early days now. It's really going to evolve a lot there. They're talking about even you can print down to atom level, which is amazing. They have these in labs these days, but it's not available yet. But when that happens, you can probably manufacture stuff with 3D printing. Not just prototyping, but for prototyping, it's really good. Yeah. A bit on these more, yeah, I touched in on this one. Raspberry Pi is partly open source. By partly, I mean the PCB is open source, but it's a system on chip, so the chip is a Broadcom stuff. So there's a hidden agenda there that they want to sell more Broadcom stuff, but that's okay. The BeagleBone is fully open source. You have lots of Arduino stuff and many, many more. And my last comment is that you really look for a community. There are so many options out there. And if you cannot find a community, even though the specs are awesome, they are much better than all the others. Look for a community. If you choose wrong, you're on your own there. And you don't want to do that. Trust me, I've tried. It's not fun. Yes, and I'm talking about hardware, and I'm meaning, of course, embedded hardware here. Going to touch briefly in on the different spectrums we have of hardware. We have all from microcontrollers, FPGAs, and system on chip, system on modules. It's really Raspberry Pi is a system on chip. It's basically this one that is the meat of the stuff. The rest is just plumbing. System on module is actually also becoming a thing where you get your whole sort of computer system in one. One module, this is a credit card size, even though it looks bigger here, that has a slot on the back. So you create your own PCB and you plug this in where your I/O is connected. Yes. And to sort of where Elixir and Nerves fits in this one, I will come back to. For the Arduino, do you know where Arduino is? Anybody played around with Arduino? Yeah, a few, not so many, but okay. It's really microcontroller. They are small, low level, very cheap, low power, and it had lots and lots and lots of I/O. Everything is a community around this one. It's really about what Arduino is doing is enabling you to create microcontrollers very fast without having to have these crazy debuggers that you attach and program them. You really use your serial port and iterate faster. And they're, of course, open hardware. Thing with these is that they are so low level that you cannot run an operating system on them. You are basically controlling everything, which is a bit hard to do sometimes, and you can really... It's a big gun to shoot yourself in the foot because you are controlling all the hardware. Yeah. FPGAs, anybody knows about FPGAs? Anybody working professionally with them? No, me too. But they're really interesting stuff, and they're becoming more and more available these days. It's basically your code compiles to transistors, which is sort of mind-boggling to think about, but you need to think about it as large homemade instructions. It's like assembly, but only big instructions. And you program actually the silicon with this. They're highly specialized, but you get a lot of performance for low power for performance, and you can really do heavy number crunching on these. And they're becoming more and more affordable. I haven't used them so much myself, but everybody that is sort of trying to predict anything in the embedded world is talking more and more about FPGAs. And I will come back to why this is a good combination with Elixir and Nerves, because you can, no, let's do that now. I started it, this one. You can basically have Elixir and Nerves as the control plane, and then you can have FPGAs doing the number crunching, because I will come back to Elixir is really not good at number crunching and string matching. It sucks on string matching too. But anyway, the controlling part is good at, and then you can drop down the heavy lifting to FPGAs. Ericsson, which is the inventor of Erlang, has done this for years, very successfully. Yeah, and then back to what I will sort of zoom in on more, it's the Raspberry Pi. This is more general purpose. System on chip, they are affordable, I said. It's in the embedded world, it's really not. It's quite expensive compared to Arduino stuff. But the Raspberry Pi 3 is really good for prototyping. It has Wi-Fi and Bluetooth built in, which is nice. And the Pi Zero, released about a year ago, I think, completely sold out immediately, $5 per board. Now they have new batches, but still they have, still a year after release, they are limited one per customer if you go to Adafruit or something like that to buy them. It doesn't have Wi-Fi, but it's very, very small. And the same open, everything is open, and it, and this is important. They run Linux. You can have a Debian clone called Raspbian running on top of it. This tiny one has about half a gig RAM, I think it is. This one has 1 gig of RAM. I saw a comparison the other day with Pentium 4, and I think it was double the performance on that one compared to Pentium 4 on this little device here. Which hardware you go for, it really the same, it depends. It really depends on your use case. I will focus on this device here, system on chip, because it's capable of running Linux, and to run Elixir and Nerves, you need to have Linux as your, you need an operating system, basically. But if your use case is low power and lots of sensors, maybe you should have a look at Arduino instead. Yes. This is one of those IDs again that maybe, is it really that important? But maybe it is. Let the world know. So, that was the hardware side. Now we're stepping into the software side of things with Elixir. And it will hopefully come together in a demo that. Let's pray to the demo god and see if that works in the end. But Elixir is built on Erlang and the Beam. So that's why I guess my talk was accepted. This is really the old new thing. But I mean it in a good way. I don't mean it ironically. You should really look at Erlang. There are so many nice factors with Elixir that makes it more approachable, I guess. Than Erlang. That's a bit nasty thing to say. Erlang is nice too, so I won't bash on Erlang because that's sort of going to be my theme here. Elixir is good because of Erlang, because it's built on the foundation. And the newest ThoughtWorks technology radar, Elixir showed up together with its technology, no, its web framework called Phoenix. And the mechanics of the language is that it's functional, robot distributed, and built on top of the Erlang actor model. I don't know if any one of you were in the introduction talk yesterday about Erlang. Natalia something talked about distributed Erlang, and everything that she talked about Erlang goes with this one as well. It's really the same foundation, which is important. It looks a bit like Ruby when you look at the code, because one of the core contributors of Elixir is Jose Valim. He's also contributed a lot on Ruby. So I guess the similarity is not by accident. And I've heard the rumor that Ruby is sort of a stolen language. It's sort of a best of patched together or hatched together. And since Elixir is stolen from Ruby and a lot of others, so maybe it's a best of, or the biggest hack ever. That depends on how you look at it. And yes, it has forward piping. I'm trying to hide that one, which is very nice. It makes the code very readable. So the sales pitch from their webpage is that it's a platform, it's a language, and there's tooling. That's really important that everything sort of comes together. It's not one of them together that is great, it's the sum of everything that makes it attractive to me. That it's scalable, that's the actor model, the supervisor tree, functional, and the extensive and DSL, it's sort of the ironic part because 90% of Elixir is actually written in Elixir, which is they are heavily using the macros themselves. So they're writing part of the language there, which is probably the ultimate dog fooding. And it's a small language. It means that it has a few, very few keywords and syntax to learn. It's very easy to get go, but it's very difficult to master because you have to build this to make it scalable and fault tolerance and all that stuff. You need to accept the OTP platform, which I will touch back on later. So you need to sort of run with it by that word escaped me. You need to play along with it, not try to force it into something else. So if you come from Ruby, which a lot of developers in Elixir, especially in the States, does, they look for, but Ruby can do this, why cannot this do that? So that's probably, look at this as a functional language, it's not Ruby, don't be deceived by it. Yes. And this is why I'm talking about that. It's sort of the inheritance from Erlang is very important. Erlang also talks about language, framework, and runtime. The framework is the language is of course functional, and the framework is something called OTP, which is the common parts that they have found. It's not a framework like the Java framework or .NET framework, but it's really those generic things that they found, and they wrote them in libraries and really battle hardened them from Ericsson since it was open sourced. Yes. That was that one. And this is sort of the background where, how they built. This is Erlang from Joe Armstrong. The world is concurrent. Things in the world don't share data. Things communicate with messages and things fail. This is sort of the problems they try to solve. They try to build telephone switches, which is actually not that different from web, what we do today. And this is, I've stolen this from Torben Hoffman. He's sort of talked about the golden trinity of Erlang, which is share nothing, fail fast, and failure handling. And you need all those parts for it to become great. And this is what I'm talking about, that you need to play along with the framework. If not, it will bite you. It's just like everything else. Need to learn its strength and play along with it. And the environment in now I'm zooming back to Elixir again. This was sort of the common thing it had with Erlang. Elixir, the thing that sort of separates it a bit from Erlang is that it's, the REPL is not separate, but it has its own IEX. Mix was something that Elixir introduced, and it was later contributed back to Erlang with the rebar, something called rebar 3. Takes a lot from Mix back to it. It has a packet manager that was also something that Elixir contributed. It sort of pushed the Erlang environment community a bit forward as well by these tools. So it has a package manager, it has a very live community on Slack, and it has a web framework, which every language with respect for itself need to have. And got a lot of attention when they demoed 2 million WebSockets on a single server. It was the biggest one they could, it was a cloud provider, I don't remember the name, and the biggest node they could do, and then they maxed out on 2 million WebSocket concurrent connections, and then they started to pass messages around. That's when they got lots of traction, in especially in US. They picked up interest on this one. And the stuff that I will zoom in on is that embedded, that it has nerves. So it's sort of, it's a multi-purpose language. Not a silver bullet, so you need to use what it's good for. And this is why I think it's good for hardware, because we have lots of concurrency going on. You can think of all the sensor data that you are collecting in hardware and all the actuators you can control, they are basically separated processes. And if you treat them like that, it's a very good fit. Distribution is sort of given that you these devices are very cheap, they can fail easily, or you can spill water on them or whatever. So you need to think of robustness and fault tolerant as well. And this is sort of maybe the sweet spot, I would say, for Elixir and Nerves, is that it's a coordinator for specialized hardware, sort of the control plane, if you like. It's very good at that one because of the concurrency engine that is built in. Yeah, and as I mentioned, this was the primary use for Ericsson for a very long time. And then Nerves, which is a framework on top of Elixir. It's really just using the tools that you have inside the Elixir world and making more deployable on hardware. It's still a bit young, so some parts are still under construction, but most of the main parts are stable and ready for prime time. And it has been used by one of the core contributors in a company called Rosie Navigation, something like that. They use it to control radars and lots of stuff on board boats. So it's definitely ready for prime time. But some of the sort of extra tooling is still a bit young. They are breaking changes all the time. So look for 1.0. They really respect the versioning. So everything below 1.0 is just stay away for a while, unless you like to get burned. Which we do, of course. So this is sort of the process when you're using Nerves. The target is to get from your development code and into the physical device in a firmware bundle, of course. You write your own project here, and then you the tooling helps you to put it on top of an OTP release. In parallel with that, you have a Linux distro with all the C libraries and Erlang runtimes that you need. We call this a system image. These have to be targeted on different devices because the Raspberry Pi is not the same as BeagleBone Black, so you need targeted images for this one. And they come together and you have your firmware bundle. And I will try to show you that after that. You're going from code and into an SD card and there you go. And it boots it boots everything. It boots the OS and starts this runtime. And they have layered the firmware, or master boot record, bootloaders, and they have what's called an AB file system, which is what they use when they upgrade. That contains everything, as we see here, the Linux kernel, the Erlang, C libraries, and OTP release. And your program on top of that, of course, which is included in their release. The reason why they have two file system is that they use that heavily for upgrading, because you need to upgrade the firmware, and then you are upgrading. If this is your running version, and you're upgrading the B file system, and you reboot, and if it's successful, it tags itself in the master boot record at the current one. If it fails and the system reboots again, it goes back to A. So this is really a way of having a fallback when you're upgrading. It's a bit fiddly to set up, but it's built in the tooling. And everything is read-only except from one little part, because yeah, we know file systems are not too happy when the power is disconnected all of a sudden, and these are small devices that and multiple reasons why the power can be disconnected. Yes, so that was the upgrade strategy as well. This is the comparison when you have made the Nerves firmware compared to Raspbian, which is the default sort of OS to run on top of a Raspberry Pi. And the boot time is 1/10. The footprint is really small. The update strategy is the whole image, which in itself seems a bit weird, but if you look at the size, it's really not a problem to deploy everything. And they have this AB partitions and root read-only root partitions. And as you see, the footprint is much smaller. A typical workflow for when you're developing this one is to keep it as close to your laptop for as long as possible, because it's really, it's a long feedback loop to go all the way to the hardware. So you like to, you would like to stay on your laptop as long as you can. So you try to connect the hardware and see if you can find adapters and developing as much as your code there. And then you maybe even remote in on the board, and a board like Raspberry Pi is that you can actually connect it with both monitor and keyboard and mouse, and you can actually work on the device. And the last step is actually Nerves. Even though I'm focusing on that one, it's really the last step to get the firmware for you. But it sort of packages everything for you. This is all about keeping the feedback loop as close as possible. It might seem obvious and sort of is, but it's just remember this one. Yes, and the last note I've put in here is that even though I've talked about SD cards, don't put SD cards in production. Just don't. They will fail. They have about 1,000 writes, and you will be very sorry if you do. I haven't done this one. I trust the people giving me that advice. This is actually all the lines of this is all the commands you need to go from zero to a firmware. This will of course don't do anything, but it will boot up with everything Linux and Erlang and the empty app running on top. The first line does really just the scaffolding, and here I'm targeting the Raspberry Pi 3, and then mix steps get pulls down the dependencies, and you compile it, and then you assemble that flow that I showed you earlier, that you put it into one firmware, and they made tooling so that it burns it onto your SD card as well. And I will hopefully be able to show this one about now. I will try to show those line of code there, and the resolution wasn't the best one here, but we will see how the terminal looks. And it's, I've talked you through what they did, so hopefully I will be able to remember them. Blinky, and then we do target, if I can type target like this. I am a bit concerned that this will take a while to know. That was fast. And then we do mix compile, and this will actually pull down more of the tooling. So this will take a while. Yeah, this, okay. Yeah, great. So I'll see if I will, if it will finish in time or if I need to cheat here. But I can show you the code in the meantime if I get this up and running here. Let's see here. Oh, okay. The resolution is not the same as on my laptop, I see. So this is a typical project in Elixir. You have the build, which is auto-generated for you. You have config that you can basically type into parameters that you want to follow with your distribution. These are dependencies that was pulled down with that mix deps get for you. You have lib, where you actually type your code, and then you have release folder, which is also part. This is also more Erlang stuff that you can put in to modify your firmware. And you have tests built in. Elixir has, of course, being that young that it is, it has a built-in test framework. I won't show that one today. Most of the meat goes on in this mix file, which is sort of the config of the project. It's a project file, if you like, and sets up everything in this one. What I will need for the demo is actually to include one more dependency, which is called Elixir Ale, which will do the IO for me, which will do the actually connection to the hardware, to the LED, I mean, to the I/O ports. Are you familiar with the I/O term, or should I, maybe I skip that definition? You have lots of pins on these, of course. That is the I/O part, and you have different protocols there. The most common one is digital 1 and 0, but there's also different protocols like I2C or SPI, or the old serial port is really still a big thing on embedded world. So, and these can sort of be all tapped into this this little line of pins, 40 pins that you can connect to different things. And there's a nice, I can show this one. Pinout does dot x, y, z shows all these, what's connected where. And some of them can be multiplex as well. They can have, it's called general purpose I/O, so they can have different functions, depending on what you need them for. So, but I need to put in Elixir Ale here, which will operate there. Then we can quickly look back and see. Oh, it's done. Good. Good, good. So I will hopefully... Yes, that's the project setup. There's also in the lib is where you actually put your Elixir code. So I will type in... I'll try to follow the convention here, which suggests that you put in a blinky folder, the same name as your project, and then you put more files under there. So I will call it blink.dx, and we will define a module and call it blinky.blink, and we will use gen server. This is part of the OTP framework. I won't talk too much about that one, but just accept that we need to use that one here. And some of this stuff is actually convention, so I will just type it in, and we start gen server dot, no, it's start link. Okay. There's a. I see that I owe you an explanation of this one, because it's it was so obvious when I typed it in when I rehearsed this one, but it's really not when I look it here. This is really the OTP inheritance of Elixir. It's a gen server, which is you're sort of using callbacks on this one, and when you say use gen server, it means that this module will really be inheriting from gen server. You don't have inherit in Elixir, but it's the same concept. You will run on top of a gen server. And a gen server has a lot of conventions. This is sort of the client code that when you call start links, it calls itself, and you will end up, the OTP will end up calling a method called init, which is also mandatory to have in a gen server. And I will connect this with the supervisor tree just after, which is another concept. Let me just type this one. GPIO start. That was wrong. And here I initiate pin 14. And I will show you which one that is after. And it's, I'm saying that this is going to be an output. So I want to define that one as that pin. I want to start a process, a separate process connected to port 14. It's going to be an output. And then I can control it after. But this is the initial initiation part. And I want the PID back for that one, which is a process ID in the Elixir Erlang world. And then I will spawn a new process, which will take in a new function and as its parameter, and we will call one method that I haven't defined yet, and I call it blink forever, and I put in that PID that I just initiated. So I will show you that blink forever just after. And then, since this is part of the gen server, I need to return something. This is a functional language, so I need to return something, and this is also mandatory to return in that state. You need to return OK if you started OK and a state. We don't keep state in this server, so I just return nothing. And I can do a def p for blink forever, which takes a PID. That's what it does. And then I use the same GPIO and I write to this one this time. And I use write to that process ID that I got up here, and I write the one. And then I do a timer.sleep for, that's not how it's written, like this, and then I write zero to that same pin. Like so, and I do timer.sleep again. Oh, come on. And then I call myself. Blink forever. And this is, if you're not familiar with functional programming language, this is weird. This is, you will run out of tool stack very soon, you think. But functional language, this is just a normal thing. You call yourself. That's the last thing you do. You go back again. So what this code will do is it's write a one to this port, and then sleep for a second, and then write zero, and then sleep for a second. And this is what it takes to blink an LED. To have it start, I need to. This is why I use the gen server here, because I want it part of the supervisor tree that starts up when this application starts. So I have to put it in the application. And both Elixir and Erlang has sort of a weird definition of an application, but just this is what it is. A project would be more correct term, but it's an application. So the application has a supervisor tree built in. When you start the application, it sort of spins off the default supervisor tree. And I want blinky blink, I think I call it, to be started with no arguments as part of that one. And what this will do is start that process I just wrote, and it will supervise it, which means that based on the strategy I put in here, I can do restarts. If it fails, I can do new restarts and all that. I won't go into the strategy part there, but this is supervision tree. If that's interesting, there's lots of good documentation on this one. And that should be it for making this blink. I will be surprised if I don't have any typos, but let's see. Mix compile. Yes, of course there is. No, I need to do mix deps get, because I put in another dependency, which will hopefully be resolved. And mix compile types like, no, come on, like this. And I have a typo, line 10 it says here. Okay. I need an end here. This is what this line does is basically start a new process. This is not a good practice here. I'm just doing this for not making this example too long. So I'm spinning another process up here, and this is an inline definition of a function, which is a short term for, instead of having to write a full function here. But then I can head back and hopefully it will compile this time. And I do mix firmware. And as I showed on that slide, this is actually going to make the firmware bundle. Then we can hopefully program an SD card after and see if it blinks. I put in the SD card and do mix firmware.burn, and it looks for if the SD card is there, and it says hard disk 2. I hope this is the right one, not my main disk. They actually made that tool fairly good, so it almost never happens. So now the SD card is burnt, and I can plug it into, and I will see if I can make this a bit easier to see. Ooh. And I plug in the SD card, the Raspberry Pi, and you will see some power, and it's 3 to 6 seconds, usually takes more like 7, I think. But so it glows up at first, and after a while it hopefully starts blinking. Maybe I did something wrong. I did something wrong, and I think I remember what it was. What I've forgotten is that, oh crap. Screensaver, hot corners on Mac is not a good idea in presentations. Just got a screensaver here. Let's see. When you pull in, this is an external dependencies, and these are also defined as applications, as I showed you these other ones. This is a full library, and I need to start it. That's what I've forgotten. So I need to actually say that I want Elixir Ale, that's how it's typed, to be started with my application. Here I just pulled in the files, and here I say that this needs to start. So it has its own supervision tree, and it has its own everything. So putting this line here in my application says that I want this to start as well. So with that, I will try again to do a mix compile. And now it doesn't take so long because all the dependencies were down, including the tooling. So let's try this one. One more firmware. Takes a long time when you're watching it. And then firmware burn. Oh, it's the same disk, so hopefully not gonna be okay now. No. Like so. It has to work because I'm running out of time now. Ah, photo booth. There we go. Now I might have switched the SD card and you didn't see. Let's see, it lights up. This has to do with the state that it's putting out electricity as it boots up. And there we go. We have Blinky. Thank you. Okay, I think that's that for that demo. Let's take this one down and continue. I originally had planned to put in another demo for, we're doing a workshop on Saturday, but I see I have absolutely not time for that one. So this is just a bit more LEDs and buttons, and I have an I squared C sensor here, which is temperature and humidity, and I just want to show, not live coded because it takes too long, but this is what we'll do on Saturday. And I've also put an API on top of that one with Phoenix, so I want to. So we will build that one, like I said, and show how you are structuring the project to do that. Okay, so this is sort of to sum up that parallel track and both tracks, is that if you can dream it, you can build, you can do it. Walt Disney phrase, and hopefully this will allow you to build it much faster with these tools. And as a last sentence, I would say that just because it can, just because you can, doesn't mean it's a great idea. Don't forget to crowdsource your stuff. You will get feedback, valuable feedback. And that was what I had. Yeah. Do we have any questions? Time for questions too. Can you deploy other software using Nerves like JDK, for example? Yes, you can. You can put in basically anything that can run on top of Linux. You can put in as additional files as you are building your firmware. You can put in a JDK. Is I think that's just recently been discussed on that Slack channel, and I think they went with actually the Oracle version because they couldn't make the OpenJDK run for some reason. But you can put in anything that can run on top there. You can put a part of your bundle. What I didn't mention was that you can actually build your own system image. If you bring out a totally new system that is just deployed and the community hasn't taken it up yet, you can build your own. You use something called build root, I think it's called, from the Linux world, and you pick and choose which parts you want part of the operating system, and then you create a system image, and you can build on top of that. So for sure you can do that. How to deal with OS hardening on the device. Is that possible? I am actually not sure what that question means, but it's a Linux operating system, so whatever you can do on top of that, you can do here too. If you don't like the versions they have put out, you can make your own.